Hi, it's Paul Andersen, and this is Disciplinary Core Idea PS1C. It's on nuclear processes. A lot of people are familiar with chemical reactions. Just like in the last video, we talked about the breaking of the bonds between atoms and the reforming of those to create new molecules. But people are generally unfamiliar with nuclear processes, and that's because the physics, in other words, the interactions at the subatomic level get real crazy. But it's not any less important. The energy from the sun is produced through a nuclear process, and so it's important that our students understand what's going on. First thing you should understand is that there are four fundamental forces or interactions in the universe, and you're probably only familiar with two. What's the first one? That's gravity. In other words, gravity is holding the Earth in orbit, and it's holding me on the Earth itself. What's another force? That would be the electromagnetic force. In other words, we found that electrons and how they move and magnetism are tied together into this one electromagnetic force. How are you familiar with that? Well, if I were to push my hands together, they don't go through each other because electromagnetic forces are opposing that. Or in other words, why don't I sink down through the Earth? It's electromagnetic forces that are responsible for that. And they're going to be much greater than gravity. How do we know that? Well, gravity is pulling you towards the center of the Earth, but the electromagnetic forces are keeping you apart. So what are the next two? Those are the strong nuclear force and the weak nuclear force. Let's start with a strong nuclear force. Where are we at? We're now looking at the nucleus. And so all of the red balls right here are going to be protons, and the other ones are going to be neutrons. And so these all have a positive charge, and then the blue have no charge or a neutral charge. And so what you might think, if you know anything about electromagnetism, is that if we have all of these positive charges right next to each other, then all of the nuclei, except for hydrogen, which just has one proton, should be inherently unstable. In other words, the protons should fly away from each other, because positive does not attract positive. In fact, it repels it. And so what's holding that nucleus together is the strong nuclear force. Why aren't we familiar with it? Because it only operates on a really small distance. And so what is it doing? It's this attraction between the neutrons and the protons that are holding the nucleus in place. And what you'll find is as we go down the periodic table, as we add more and more protons, or in other words, more and more of these positive charges, we have to add more and more neutrons to just hold that nucleus together. And so that's the strong nuclear force. What's the weak nuclear force? It's even weirder than that. What's going on with the weak nuclear force? Well, occasionally, if we look at inside the protons and neutrons, they're made up of things called quarks. And what can occur is that some of these, let's watch this one right here, can actually turn from a proton into a neutron, and it gives off something called an electron, and the opposite can occur as we give off a positron. And this has to do with quarks and neutrinos, and your head is probably spinning. It's not super important that you understand what's going on, but that you know that it exists. And so what's going to occur with that is we have radioactive decay, and so the nuclei can break down or change form over time. And so why is this important? Well, let's start with the first reactions, or these strong nuclear forces. What that can occur is we can get fusion. And fusion occurs is when we have smaller nuclei fusing together to make larger nuclei. So here we have two hydrogen nuclei that are fusing together to make a helium nuclei. What does that create? It creates a huge amount of energy. So now we're dealing with E equals mc squared. Where we can decrease the amount of mass, but we can release a huge amount of energy. And so where's the energy of the sun coming from? It's coming from fusion of hydrogen into helium. And this continues on. Helium can be fused again, and we can move up the periodic table. What's fission then? Fission is going to be when we have a big molecule. Here we're looking at uranium-235. That can be hit by another particle, and we can break it down into two different molecules. That's what fission is, or it's the breakdown of the nuclei. Now, if we go back to fusion, this doesn't occur on our planet. I mean, it has just a few times in nuclear explosions, but fission occurs all the time. Why doesn't fusion occur here? It's because you have to have a huge amount of temperature and pressure to have it go. Fission is going to be a breakdown, and so an atomic bomb is going to be usually a fission bomb, where we seed it and then we just have explode. So we have fission, fission, fission. We have this chain reaction. We also can harness that in nuclear power as well. We can take the energy that's being released and we can use that to run steam turbines and produce electricity. What's decay? Remember, decay is when we're changing from one atom to another atom. So what's an example? A famous one is carbon-14. Carbon-14 can undergo radioactive decay. It can lose an electron and it can turn into nitrogen. Well, why is that important? On our planet, most of the carbon is all carbon-12. It's got 6 protons and 6 neutrons, but a little bit of it is carbon-14, and it's radioactive. That means it is going to break down, and as it does that, we can measure the rate at which it does that. It's called radiometric dating. We can see how old things are. And so we could look at the living material, so like the wood that was found in these tombs, and we can date it using carbon-14 dating. What's nice about that is that we can play that against the written record, and we can look at a written record of the pharaohs, and we can figure out how accurate it actually is. Now, as we get decay, we get different forms of radiation. We can have alpha, beta, and gamma particles that are given off. In this case, we'd have beta decay. So let's talk about how you should cover this in elementary grades. And the nice answer is that you shouldn't. If you look at the breakdown, they say that you shouldn't talk about nuclear processes in elementary. We shouldn't really cover it until we get into middle school. And so you can breathe a sigh of relief if you're an elementary teacher, but if you're a middle school teacher, what should you talk about? Well, you should start by talking about fusion. Fusion's important because that produces the energy in stars. What do we need to get fusion going? We need high temperature, and we also need high pressure. And so we don't have fusion going on our planet, and that's because we don't have enough mass to create enough pressure, to create enough temperature. But all the energy coming from stars is coming from nuclear fusion that's going on. A cool quote from Carl Sagan said that we are all star stuff. What does he mean by that? Well, this occurs just for a little bit. So we can take hydrogen, fuse it into helium. We can then get up to iron. But as we get bigger and bigger and bigger, we really can't make larger molecules. And so we're made up of pretty complex molecules. And so where did we come from, the parts of us? Well, anything on our planet that's not hydrogen and helium had to come from stars and the formation of stars and the explosion of stars. And so we literally are made of star dust. As you move into high school, then you should talk about these three processes: fusion, which is the combination of the nuclei, fission, which is the breakdown, and then radioactive decay. What's causing that? It's the binding energies. In other words, the energies that are holding that nuclei together. And know this, that just like in chemical reactions, the mass is conserved, in nuclear processes or reactions, the nucleons are going to be conserved. What does that mean? The protons and the neutrons are going to stay the same. So even though we may have fusion here and we're creating helium, we still have the same number of protons and neutrons, the total number. And even though we may have decay where one is turning into another, the total number of nucleons is going to be conserved. What's an important application, especially for me, like in biology, radiometric dating is an important thing that you should understand, a nuclear process. How does this occur? Remember, a small portion of carbon is carbon-14, but that's going to break down into nitrogen. And so how often does that occur? Well, it has a half-life of 5,730 years. What does that mean? In 5,730 years, about half of the carbon is going to turn back into nitrogen or turn into nitrogen. And we can measure that. So if we were to measure a sample, a living material, after 5,730 years, it will have about half of the carbon-14 that it should have. And what I mean should have, that it would normally right now just in the environment. So what's going to happen over the next 5,000 years? Half of that that hasn't decayed is going to decay. And then half of that is going to decay. And so after 17,000 years, we should have 12.5%. And so we could graph this right here. We could look at a sample, and then we could use that sample and the amount of carbon-14 in it to figure out how old it is. Now, my model here is really simplistic. There's going to be millions, if not billions and billions of these molecules in a sample, and so we can get highly accurate results. Up to about 50,000 years. Then what do? We're going to have to switch to a different isotope that we can measure. Last thing I would leave you with is this, that in most stars, we can get up to about the level of carbon through fusion or the combining of the nuclei. In really big stars, we could maybe get up into iron. But where does the rest of the periodic table come from? It comes from supernova. And so this is going to be explosion of supermassive stars. They release a huge amount of energy, where the light from one star outshines all of that in the sky. These are going to be rare, but that's how we get everything on the periodic table up from iron, or larger in size from iron. And so those are nuclear processes. We don't deal with them on a day-to-day life, but they're just as important in chemical reactions, and I hope that was helpful.